Hello, I'm Rebecca, the assistant curator here at Showtown. And today we're going to be taking a bit of a whistle-stop tour into the history of ballroom dancing. And 100 years ago, the world's biggest, most famous, and most prestigious dance festival was created. And people travel there from all over the world. Are we talking about London, Paris, Beijing? No, we're talking about the Blackpool Dance Festival. And today we'll uncover how this amazing event came to be here in Blackpool. And people often refer to Blackpool as the spiritual home of ballroom dancing. Its reputation is international. When the Berlin Wall fell in 1989, a television interviewer asked a couple there what they wanted to do now. And their response was to dance in Blackpool. Now we know that throughout history, people have always loved to dance. Many different cultures across the world have developed their own styles of dancing. But in Europe, around the 16th century, people had ballrooms in their large, stately homes. And so ballroom dancing for a long time was considered to be quite an upper class activity. But even later, when the upper classes began to decline, one of the only ways to learn a ballroom dance was to buy a book or to go for expensive lessons, which many people either couldn't afford or didn't have the time to do. But then in the early 20th century, wages increased, and so did leisure time for the working class market. Ballroom dancing began to be offered in more public venues, which opened it up to a lot more people. An example of this happened here in Blackpool. In 1863, the North Pier was opened. It was aimed at the wealthy so that they could promenade close to the sea in style. A charge was actually introduced at the entrance to try and exclude poorer people from accessing the pier and maintain its exclusive reputation. But soon the masses had somewhere to call their own when a second pier was opened in 1868. It was a controversial decision, and at first it wasn't popular. But then open air dancing was advertised, and this really appealed to the working class market. They flocked to the pier to dance to live German bands, let their hair down and have a bit of fun. The pier, which we now know as Central Pier, quickly became known as the People's Pier. And this is a good example of one of the main reasons that Blackpool was transformed into a bustling seaside town. It was due to the entrepreneurial spirit of the people who lived and worked here. Seeing how popular dance was in Blackpool, and knowing that people wanted to escape their working lives, beautiful, opulent ballrooms were created to accommodate this interest in ballroom dancing. The Tower Ballroom came first in 1894, quickly followed by the Empress Ballroom and then the Alhambra, which soon after became the Palace. Cheap admission, glamorous surroundings, sprung ballroom floors, and high quality bands soon made Blackpool the place to dance. And they also led the way on the amount of dancing on offer, often every night during the summer season. So here we are at the start of the 20th century, but what dances were people doing in the ballrooms and what had influenced them? Well, the answer lies in America. Slavery had officially been abolished there in 1865, and black communities had settled across the country. The music and dances that they were creating reflected their newfound liberation with offbeat rhythms and lively movements. And this music became known as ragtime. And it caught the interest of the younger generations of Britain who wanted to rebel against the formal dances of the past. Some of these new novelty dances included the turkey trot and the grizzly bear. But the most well-known today is probably the foxtrot. And these dances really changed things up in the world of social dancing. Before this, ballroom was a lot stricter, without much room for improvisation, and these new dances were more free and exciting. Yet some people were not impressed. Prejudices held against the black communities meant that some people saw these dances as inferior. Others were more worried about the rules, and they were concerned that this freer form of dancing would mean the standards and traditions of ballroom dancing would be lost. One famous ballroom couple called Irene and Vernon Castle were very outspoken about maintaining ballroom standards. They even came up with their own set of house rules to maintain your dignity. These included: do not wriggle the shoulders, do not shake the hips, do not flounce the elbows. Remember, you're at a social gathering and not in a gymnasium. Drop the turkey trot and the grizzly bear. These dances are ugly, ungraceful, and out of fashion. But novelty dances were big business in ballrooms and dance halls at this time. The First World War was looming and people just wanted to have a bit of fun. To attract the crowds, ballroom band leaders created new novelty dances to keep the public interested. Then music publishers like Blackpool's Lawrence Wright would publish this sheet music. The invention of the gramophone and wireless radio meant that people were now listening to music in their own homes. They therefore bought the sheet music to play at the piano, which often had the steps printed on the back, or they danced to radio broadcasts. In 1920, the jazz era really took off, and lively dancers like the Charleston were taking ballrooms by storm. But not everyone was impressed. In 1920, Philip Richardson, the editor of the Dancing Times, called a meeting with 200 British dance teachers. Together, they agreed to stamp out what they called freakish dancing and restore ballroom's good reputation. In the years that followed, this committee standardised the steps of the tango, waltz and foxtrot. The rules and techniques for each dance were recorded and circulated in booklets, guides and newspaper articles. This style of dancing became known as the English style. And when it was created in the same year, the Blackpool Dance Festival was therefore the best of both worlds. It would create new, exciting dances for people to perform, whilst also maintaining the highest professional ballroom standards. It was also sponsored by the Blackpool sheet music publishers Sharples and Sons. Originally, competitors were asked to create new dances for the waltz, two-step and foxtrot. There was one competition each day, and on the fourth night, one dance was chosen as the overall winner. So dance competitions like the Blackpool Dance Festival were a huge part of standardising ballroom. Official rules for dance and etiquette were established in 1924, which only added to the prestigious reputation of these festivals. The first festival trophy, which survives in the Blackpool Heritage Collection, was won by Harry Roscoe for his novelty waltz, Valse Elita. And the Blackpool Dance Festival was originally a Northern England and Scottish competition, but its biggest turning point came in 1931, when the festival expanded to include British amateur and professional open championships, and that's what really put it on the map. And it went from strength to strength. Its impressive panel of expert judges and the beautiful setting of the Empress Ballroom had the dance world buzzing. In the 1950s, when commercial air travel really took off, dancers began to come from all over the world. But since the beginning, the objective of the festival, to really celebrate the best of ballroom dancing, has remained. Today, across the world, ballroom competitions include same-sex couples, wheelchair users, and young people, because nobody should feel excluded from being able to have a dance. So why not have a go yourself and let us know how you get on? Thank you very much for listening.